Pastor David Cherry. He's the pastor from Wagga Wagga. Called in here on his way through. We have got a children's talk, so be prepared to send your kids up if they will go. And we've got Holy Communion. And we'd like you to come down that row and that row and then feed back as you go back. Just watch the cords over there, that's all. And just a little way into the service is a time for announcements. So if you've got something to announce, that's the time. So just sit back and we'll listen to a song and then we'll start. Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. theme for today is the same as the Synod theme, is the gift of God, it's grace that unites us. There is more than doctrine that unites us. Why do we call the Baptists and the Catholics and the Pentecostals, why do we call all those people brothers and sisters in Christ? It's because of grace that unites us. We're on the same side of the great divide. We're going to talk about that today, more about that in a minute. It's God's grace that unites us. I'd just like to invite anybody who'd like to make an announcement. While they're thinking about it, that I came back from Newcastle Tuesday this week, I think, and came across this at Lamaru, this picture. It's just been finished. And I couldn't help but thinking as we're riding along, we've got to pray for the farmers and rural communities. As you know, things are bad. You know, we're struggling with no rain, very poor rain, and then what crop has grown, it's been devastated by frost. Local milk factory is in receivership. We need to pray. So on the front of your bulletin, that's my announcement, we're holding a prayer meeting out there, in front of that silo, on October the 20th at 3 p.m. And it's open to anybody, ecumenical thing. It'd be great to see some people there. If not, it'll just be me.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Tanya Henkel, and welcome today to the service, and thank you, Pastor Dave, for leading us. I'm just announcing, because in the bulletin there's been some announcements about the Callington show, which I'm coordinating with Gloria's help still, and just asking for anyone who's able to bake to come and get a information leaflet from me, because there's certain things that we'd like you to do for that. I'll be, after the service, over at the tea and coffee, so please come over there and have a cuppa afterwards too. Thank you.
Good. No one else?
You need help next Tuesday?
That I need help?
Yes.
No, you need help. The ladies need help next Tuesday setting up for the ladies' conference, this church-wide Australian ladies' conference. Lutheran ladies' conference is here? Yeah.
In the stadium.
And we need some fellas to help set up. I won't be here, I'll be down at Synod.
But time,
yeah, what time? Is that what you're going to say? What time?
I haven't found out. No one's given me any information.
Oh, thank you.
I'm president of Queensland.
Yeah.
We have meetings on Tuesday morning, and then after we have lunch, we're all coming down here as executive to help set up. So it'll be after lunch on
here. So shall we say 1:30 or something?
1:30. Yeah. Well, we've got meetings in the morning.
Yeah.
Can we make it 9 a.m. and 9:30, because the tables and chairs are arriving then, and so if we can set them up then.
Yeah.
Yep. And pack up on Thursday from 2 p.m. onwards.
Yeah. All right. So 9 a.m. on the Tuesday morning of next week.
Yes.
This week. Help the ladies, otherwise they won't be able to sit down. Joanne's got a new announcement, something new. Something brand new.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the service and thanks for coming today. Look, as your chair of Murray Bay Lutheran Community Congregation, I just want to update you on a couple of things that council have put in place and are working with the ladies in the offices. We had our meeting on Wednesday. As at the request of the members at the AGM earlier this year, we are going to bring all our offices together as one. And this will happen on the 9th of October, or 10th of October, the week of the 8th of October. It'll be a transition process, but from that time onwards, the office will work out of the Holy Cross site, and the Christchurch site will be utilised for meetings, and potentially down the road, we will be able to do what we've done at Holy Cross and maybe rent some of those facilities out to give us a bit more income. So if anyone wants to know any more about that, please speak to me or any other member of council. But hopefully this is the beginning of NVLC coming together again in a different way, and that's through administration. We want to thank the ladies in the offices for working with us in this. And I hope I'm not being presumptuous, but the other thing is that on the 18th of October, one of the ladies in our office, Annette Pierce, will retire after many years of service. And so I would like you to keep her all in your prayers, and if you have the opportunity to wish her well at any stage, I'm sure she'd be happy for a conversation on that. So there's just a couple of things for you to consider. Thank you.
No more announcements? The op shop sale coming up. Send all your unwanted, useless items. Send your husbands as well. For those who don't have children, for those who have children and don't know it, we have a nursery downstairs. The low self-esteem group will meet at the back of the... If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. It says in 1 John. So let's pray. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Father, it is the work of the Holy Spirit to acknowledge our sins and turn to you for forgiveness. We confess that we have sinned against you in all that we say and do. We ask for your mercy. We ask for your forgiveness. As Jesus died on the cross for us, we ask to be made right with you and live in peace. As we receive your promise of forgiveness, let us live a life of love and love for all people. So upon that confession, I ask you in the presence of God who searches the heart, do you confess that you have sinned and do you repent of your sins?
Amen.
Do you believe that Jesus Christ has redeemed you from all your sins and do you desire forgiveness in his name?
Amen.
Do you intend with the help of the Holy Spirit to live as in God's presence and to strive daily to lead a holy life, even though Christ has made you holy?
Amen.
Christ gave to the church the authority to forgive the sins of those who repent and to declare to those who do not repent that the sins are not forgiven. Therefore, upon your confession, I, as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God to all of you. And on behalf of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you. And we sing.
Thank you. be with you.
And also with you.
Father, we pray that we hear the call for this unity of spirit in these readings. Let your Holy Spirit open our hearts so that we hear Jesus' intention for our lives.
Amen.
The first reading comes from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 14 to 22. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundations of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. In him, you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10 to 18. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought. My brothers and sisters, some of Chloe's household have informed me that there are quarrels among you. What I mean is this: one of you say, I follow Paul, another, I follow Apollos, another, I follow Cephas, and still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I did not baptize any of you except Crispus and Gaius. So no one can say that you were baptized in my name. Yes, I also baptized the household of Stephanus. Beyond that, I don't remember if I have baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Not with wisdom and eloquence, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. For the message of the Christ is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The gospel is written in John chapter 17, reading verses 20 to 23. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Luke 12:49-56. I have come to set the world on fire, and I wish it were already burning. I have a terrible baptism of suffering ahead of me, and I am under a heavy burden until it is accomplished. Do you think I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I have come to divide people against each other. From now on, families will be split apart, three in favour of me and two against, or two in favour and three against. Father will be divided against son, and son against father.
mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, and mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. Then Jesus turned to the crowd and said, "When you see clouds beginning to form in the west, you say, 'Here comes a shower.' And you are right. When the south wind blows, you say, 'Today will be a scorcher.' And it is. You fools, you know how to interpret the weather signs of the earth and the sky, but you don't know how to interpret the present times." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So, divide and conquer, or divide and rule. Have you heard that? Divide et impera. The greatest warmongers of all time have used this strategy over and over again. Actually, it's a mathematical term. When you have this difficult mathematical problem, if you break it all up into little pieces and solve all the little pieces, you solve the bigger problem. Can you imagine something like the Adelaide Post Office and all the letters, all the parcels? What a mess. Then they're divided and sorted one by one, put into different geographical piles, SA, New South Wales, WA, United Kingdom, USA, wherever it might be. Then they're sorted into regions, 5253, 5254. Then they're sorted into house numbers, or PO box numbers. My new mailing address, or our new mailing address, is DJ and I, Kuss, PO box 320, Monarto South, SA 5254. Thanks to Rob Schubert. It's a great little address. We often get mail from the mother-in-law. 5 Brückenstrasse, Friedrichstadt, 25840 Schleswig-Holstein, Deutschland. Can you imagine the massive pile of letters that go into the main post office in Germany? And they're divided, and one of them makes it to 320, P.O. Box 320, Monarto South. Divide and conquer is the postie's motto. A pity the post, my mother-in-law's postie, that's for sure. She's got this vicious dog. I've seen it, I've seen it in action. But her dog can do nothing wrong, as far as she's concerned. One day the dog grabbed hold of the postie's leg and biting him really hard. The postie yelled out, "Hey, your dog's biting me." And she said, "Don't worry, his bark is worse than his bite." And he yelled back, "Well, don't let him bark, because this bite's really hurting." Yeah, this, the dog rules on that place. Anyway, divide and conquer. The question is, does Jesus divide and conquer? Does the devil divide and conquer? Look, we all love Jesus, don't we? Even non-Christians like Jesus. He's loving and caring. He's a good teacher. He's a good provider. He heals. He feeds. His name shall be called Prince of Peace. One day, Luke 12, Jesus asked the disciples, "Do you think that I have come to bring peace on earth?" What do you think? You might be surprised. Jesus says, "No, I tell you, I came to bring division." Does Jesus divide and conquer? Look, I'm sure we'd rather talk about the Jesus who brings unity. But somehow on this Unity Sunday, we have to wrestle with God's word, which clearly says Jesus came to divide. That's what we heard. Didn't we just hear that? "I've come to divide people against each other. From now on, families will be split apart. Father will be against son, son against father, mother against daughter, daughter against mother, and mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. We did hear that, didn't we?
Yeah.
There is no person more loved than Jesus. He's been worshipped by millions and millions of people for the last 2,000 years. He's the number one focus of the world's best-selling book. More books have been written about him. More art has been created of him. More songs written about him. More buildings built to honour him. And more meetings have been held to talk about him than any other person who has ever lived. They've reset the calendars around his death and resurrection. No one has ever been more popular than Jesus, even the Beatles. You know, there is no other person who has been and still is hated more than Jesus. You might say, what about Hitler or Pol Pot or something like that? Jesus was hated as a baby. Herod killed thousands and thousands of little baby boys in the hope of killing Jesus. Some of you might dislike Donald Trump. He's had 2 attempts on his life. Jesus has 6 attempts on his life. Finally, they tortured and killed him after they found him innocent. Now that's hate. In the day, people hated Jesus so much that if you were a Christian, if you were on Jesus' side, you would be also tortured and killed. And to save their lives, they had to communicate in special ways. You know, the secret fish symbol. You know, they draw it in the sand with their shoe. Just to communicate secretly that they were Christians. The hate for those who love Jesus has continued right throughout time. The Voice of the Martyrs, an organisation, you might even be a part of it, will tell you that more than 1 million Christians have been killed, murdered, in the last 10 years, simply for loving Jesus. No one more loved, no one more hated. How would you be? How would you like to be that? John says, if the world hates you, or Jesus says, if the world hates you, you know that it has hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. This is Jesus' promise to all Christians. Let's join the club. Jesus is a divider. I chose you out of the world, out of your family, out of your community, out of your comfort zone to be with me. The days are here. We live in a post-Christian world. I don't know if you've heard that. We're a post-Christian world. We're no longer a Christian world or a Christian nation, especially here in Australia. You know, we cry and despair here every day. The church is declining. We used to have 100 kids at Sunday school, all that sort of stuff. Remember, we are a minority, even here in our own country. The divide between Christians and non-Christians is becoming more and more obvious, and maybe in our own country more and more dangerous. We will be exposed, like pouring the dirt into the refiner's fire and finding the gold. The gold can't be missed. Jesus is the divider. He uses a sword. What a better thing to divide. Hebrews 4. For the word of God is alive and powerful. It is sharper than the sharpest two-edged sword, cutting between the soul and the spirit, between joint and marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. When people believe in Jesus, they are no longer like the rest of humanity, as it says in Ephesians. All of a sudden there's 2 camps, believers and non-believers. Jesus is the divider. When a person trusts Jesus or warms to Jesus, believes in Jesus, their life is changed. They have new thoughts, new values, new dreams. Faith draws us to Jesus and also draws us to others with faith. Our personal relationships change or move away from those we know toward those we don't really know, but we love and trust because we share the faith in Jesus. I'm drawn to you people. I don't really know all of you, but I'm drawn because of our common faith and trust in Jesus. All of a sudden, we are in the world of those who know and trust Jesus and those who don't know Jesus. All of a sudden, we find ourselves wanting those on that side to be on our side. Jesus is the divider. Make no mistakes, there are two sides. Inevitably, there will be fathers and sons divided, mothers and daughters divided. All of a sudden, things which don't really matter to you will become vital to you. Can we abort a full-term baby? Someone has to say no for God. Can this school here, right here, have people of Islam faith teach our kids? They have to. Government rule. Someone has to be the voice of God. Can we tolerate this Christian school teaching our kids abnormal things about sex? Things which God doesn't want them to do? They have to. Government rule. Someone has to be God's voice. All of a sudden, we're on the side that has to make a stand. All of a sudden, there's no middle ground. Jesus says, whoever is not with me is against me. Jesus is the divider. The call to follow Jesus is not easy. It requires total loyalty and commitment. Not everyone is prepared to pay the price. Not everyone is prepared to accept those who pay the price. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can risk this division. And here it is. In this division, and all that goes with it, against all odds, against all reason, Jesus says we will find peace. And we'll look forward to the peace he'll bring you here on earth as it is in heaven. You see, it's funny, it's Unity Sunday, we're talking about division. And that's just it. There is a great divide. But on the side of Jesus, there's an unbreakable, eternal unity. We did hear also that Jesus has brought unity. He's destroyed the dividing wall. The dividing wall was our sin. He's destroyed our sin. He took our sin away. He paid for our sin with his blood. You see, in a way, unity and division are one and the same thing. We were separated from God by sin, and Jesus took on the sin of the world. He became our sin, and he united us so we could be free, pure people of God. He separated us from the world of Satan to unite us in God's kingdom. There are still two camps, but we are united in the one camp, in Jesus' camp. We are united as one, along with the Catholics and the Baptists and the Pentecostals and so on. Unity is trust and faith in Jesus. It's not doctrines. It's our trust and faith in Jesus. Here is a man praying. Praying to Jesus, trusting and hoping in Jesus alone. Is he a Lutheran? Is he a Catholic? Is he a Pentecostal? Who taught him? What's his stand on women's ordination? He looks like a Baptist to me. He's one of us. There's not a single doctrine dividing him from us. We're in the same boat as him, the same camp, trusting Jesus, looking to Jesus for our every need, thanking Jesus. We heard that Jesus has reconciled us and made us right to be in his camp. And now we also hear that he privileges us with the ministry of reconciliation. Now that sounds like a pastor thing, doesn't it? But it's not. It's for everybody. The ministry of reconciliation. It's a privilege for all of us. I believe this man is the answer to Jesus' prayer in John 17. We heard it. Jesus prayed that we be united into the very heart of the Father and the Son by the Holy Spirit. Here it is. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may they, that's us, also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. By our faith in Jesus, by our trust in Jesus, we pray that the other camp, those divided off, often our own families, may know and love and believe in Jesus. We are united because Jesus has divided us away from the power of Satan into the kingdom of God. Jesus is the divider. The sheep from the goats, the wheat from the tares. This man, I believe, is a symbol of what unites us perfectly. And that is trust and faith in Jesus. Of course, if he is a Baptist, I suspect he is, he has that look. We have massive differences, massive. But we're united. And that's the centered theme. It is grace that unites us. Let's pray. Father, let's join with all Christians praying for rain and provision, for blessings and peace, so we can be your hands and feet in this part of the world. In Jesus' name. Amen. And we sing. This will be our offering song. Thank you. faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. I'll invite our prayers up to pray.
Let us pray. Prayers for our town and country. Father, you have revealed your plans to us. You say through Jeremiah, "For I know the plans I have for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Father, upon your plans, we pray for our country, that it be a place of peace and a source of peace for troubled nations. Bless our Prime Minister. Bless all those who serve us in government, federal, state, and local. We pray your blessing on our Mayor, Wayne Thorley. We pray your protection on this town and all communities in the Murray Valley. We pray your protection on our police, medical people, and emergency services. Bless our schools, our teachers and staff. Bless all those who serve us. Bless our Christian communities, our churches and schools, our kindy and the long roads. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Father, we pray for our MVLC people, for those grieving the loss of loved ones, especially the family of Glenn Cook. Be with all those grieving and all those facing their first year alone. Watch over our very young and our elderly. Father, send your healing spirit to all those who are unwell. Lord, we pray for those whose lives have changed, for Graham and Marlene Schubert, for Ross and Sandra Tierley. We give you thanks for all who serve us, our administration, our chairperson Joanne, our committees and our volunteers. Lord, in your mercy.
Prayer for rain. Jesus says, "The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The Lord who provides eternal life is the same Lord who abundantly provides for you in times of difficulty and drought. Lord our God, look down upon our dry lands and send rain to preserve life and bring confidence to our rural community. Lord, bless those who are struggling financially, psychologically, socially, or spiritually with a renewed hope in your provision. Provide them with eternal hope and help them survive one day at a time. Send our clouds of water to rain down upon us as your righteousness and love rain down upon our hearts. Fill us with faith and trust in you that we may give you glory now and in your Heavenly Father's presence. through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
For those who are troubled, we pray with Isaiah. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. We ask your blessing on the Lamaru prayer meeting. Through this, help send a message that we care and appreciate farmers and rural communities, that we are asking God to bless them. Lord, we ask all these things standing confidently with Jesus and the Holy Spirit alongside us. Amen.
Places, give thanks to you through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit is one God. We confess that you are the one, only true God who unites all people with love and grace, and so with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven. We adore and praise your glorious name, saying,
Holy, holy, holy is your name.
And we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
The writer of the Hebrews says to us, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Jesus says to us, very truly I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. So Jesus gives all people his life's body and blood to eat and drink. And on the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup after the supper. And when he'd given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, drink of it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.
O Christ, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us your peace. Amen.
So come for all things and are ready, and invite the servers to come first. Let's stand. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his holy precious blood strengthen and preserve you both in body and in soul unto life eternal. Go in peace.
Amen.
As a prayer of thanks, we're going to sing Majesty.
Thank you.
Can we have some kids here? We're going to tie this service all together. What we got out here? What have we got out here? What's all these things? What are they? What are they? Cars. Okay. Can you give me a car? Give me one. Thank you. What's a bus? Give me a car. 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 Thank you. Can I have a car? Yeah. Deanna, give me a car. Anyone? That one. Right. No. You give me that car. So, you gave me some cars. I said, give me a car, and look what you give me. All these different cars. Is that a car? Is that a car? Look how different they are. That's a jet. We don't want jets or buses, just cars. Lots of different cars. They're all different, but they're cars, aren't they? That's what we've been talking about. As Christians, we're so, so different. Look at all these people. And other churches in town. What's some other ones? The Lifehouse Church? What else?
Bridge City.
Uniting?
Catholic.
And we're all united by Jesus Christ. Church of Christ. Anglican. Is it Baptist?
Yes.
Long Riders Church is right as we're speaking. Yeah. Salvation Army. Seventh-day Adventist. That was yesterday. So, all Christians are different, but we all belong to Jesus. We're united by His grace and faith. Thank you. You can keep playing then. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and always.
Amen.
We've got another little film clip, the Central Australian Aboriginal Ladies Choir. And it goes for quite a while, so I think we'll listen to a little bit of it, and then we can just start peeling off, or you can just stay and watch. And we're going to stand and say this psalm together, the psalm of unity. Let's go back to the psalm first. This is our closing psalm. Together. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity. It's like precious oil poured on the head, running down on the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down on the collar of his robes. It is as if the beauty of the woman were falling on Mount Zion, for there